Greetings, Guardians. My name is Bife here. So, let's talk Toland the Shattered. It's a very complex topic, this one, so there might actually be more videos on this than just the one. In fact, it's not just something that will probably break up due to complexity, but also due to the volume of stories that we can tell of Toland. It's pretty vast in some terms, but there are some serious holes in his story too. So with all of that, I want to leave this series in an open-ended manner so that we can fill in the gaps as we go. With all of that said, I think the correct place to start is with what is probably the basic history of Toland. In later videos, we'll probably cover his philosophy and talk about later notes to do with what he's done and talk about quotes here and there, and also talk about the important implications of his beliefs and where he believes the future goes. With all of that said, let's talk about the history of Toland the Shattered, or at least the history that we know of. The thing about that history of Toland is that up till the moment at which he's included in the first Crota fireteam, he's almost completely unheard of. We know that he had at least some form of discourse with Osiris, as he refers to how he wishes he could commune with him again whilst he's waxing lyrical in the Ascendant realm. This points to Toland as being a guardian who was around before Osiris's exile, or at least being a guardian who had met Osiris in his exile. Regardless of which reality it is, this indicates that the time period within which Toland might have started his time in the city as a guardian is vast. It covers most of the City Age for sure, and possibly the later stages of the Dark Age that preceded it. Aside from his affiliation with the other famously exiled Warlock, Toland has very few moments in the city's history where his tale is actually recorded. Something that will seem remarkable to all of you is that in spite of the fact that we know Toland was exiled for heretical views, the circumstances surrounding that exile are almost completely undocumented. The only real thing we know is that his exile was due to his belief in the power of the darkness and what we would one day come to know as the Sword Logic. And if that's a surprise or alarming to any of you, hi, welcome. You might be new, and if so, don't worry, we're going to talk about that a lot. It's important for the sake of context. There are a few takeaways from the fact that almost no details of his exile exist. The first takeaway that I have is the fact that information and recording of events in the city is imperfect, as one should expect it to be in any post-apocalyptic setting. The other takeaway is, however, much more troubling, because it points to what one of the stolen intelligence lore cards brings up, which is that members of The Hidden, a shadowy intelligence organization controlled by the Vanguard, can recommend to the Cryptarchs that some information isn't circulated widely in legitimate publications. For those of you who want to know what I'm talking about, look into the lore entry entitled Ringer, which you can obtain by spending Vanguard tokens to find the stolen intelligence lore book. This points to what I'm getting at, which is the idea that a guardian going rogue with some soundness of mind is something that would directly undermine the credibility of the Guardian Orders and the Vanguard. As a result, it's entirely possible that the titles that the Guardians gave to Toland, such as Mad and Shattered, were fabricated to frame him as a crazy old man who wasn't representative of mainstream Guardian society. Again, that's merely a possible take. It is entirely possible as well that these accounts of him being mad and being shattered are exactly as they represent themselves, the truth. But again, it's hard for us to know. We were not there at the time of his exile, and we were not able to see the decision of the Vanguard in motion. With all of that said, Toland's exile did most certainly occur, and the next time anyone would hear of him would be when he was approached by a warlock and a hunter, bent on revenge. Eriana III of the Praxic Order, and Eris Morn of the Hidden. Following the Battle of Mare Ibrium, they would approach Toland in search of knowledge and guidance in their fight against the Hive, and they would recruit Toland to their cause. Thus, the fireteam would march upon the Hellmouth with the exiled Master of Hive Arcana at their side. The fireteam marched for many reasons. Principal amongst them was Eriana's vengeance against Crota for the slaughter of her lover, Wei Ning, and the determination of guardians like Veltalo and Eris Morn to see a dangerous threat put to rest. However, Toland's motivations were almost completely divergent from the rest of the fire teams. It is true that whilst Eriana wished for revenge, and Vel sought justice against the Eater of Hope, Toland sought instead knowledge and power. In particular, he wished to see and experience the power of a particularly dark hive ritual known as the Death Song, performed by Death Singers, such as Ur-Yut, Ur-Ariam, Ur-Anuk, and Ur-Halak. Death Singers are hive wizards who've distorted an ancient song of life and twisted it into a terrible aria designed to murder all those that hear it. It is one of the hive's most terrible weapons, and at its most potent, it is capable of destroying entire worlds. But on an individual scale, it can still easily eradicate an entire fireteam. Toland suffered this fate, and as he communed with the Death Singer Ur-Yut within Crota's Ascendant Realm, his body was eviscerated, and his soul was sent spiraling into the Sea of Screams. It appeared to many that this was the end of Toland's tale. But as was once said, news of my death has been greatly exaggerated. He wasn't gone whatsoever. Back since the Dark Below, we've seen a variety of writings in the grimoire that clearly are written by Toland after the moment of his death. Since the Taken King, we've seen a strange white orb guiding us through Hive territory within the Dreadnought. In the end, it was only when we reached the Dreaming City that the orb began to reappear, and finally spoke to us. It made it clear that it had been Toland, and that it had been communing with both us and Eris for quite some time, slipping us messages and warnings to aid us in our fight. Toland now takes a more active role than ever in the Tale of Destiny, and has become something both less and more than any other Guardian, having gleaned knowledge of the Ascendant Realms and having lost his physical form. We can both now find Toland on the moon and within the Ascendant Realm pockets in the Dreaming City. And there, he will act as a guide to us once more, and speak of the Hive, fallen, humans, awoken, or any others that occupy the spaces amongst the Ascendant Plane. It's a strange thing now to consider that he isn't dead, but we can still see more of his story from the remnants of his ghost and his nightmare. Let's listen to both now.
This is the final transmission of Gurren, ghost of Toland, whom you call the Shattered. He goes to hear the song of death. Nothing will deter him. None of you can stop him. Not anymore. Toland will hear the Death Singer's melody. He will redefine death, escape the Traveler's Blunt Samsara. He will sound the depths of the powers you so myopically fear. My only regret is that I will not live to see his triumph.
Welcome once more to the edge of oblivion, hero. You have faced much, enough to impress the easily impressed. But the melody we seek to cage may be more than you can overcome.
Is that concern I hear in the old man's voice? Maybe his humanity isn't lost after all.
My concern extends only to all we gain to learn from what comes next. Succeed or fail, Guardian. Either way, new understandings will be gleaned from your courage. Beyond, the choir awaits. Quiet the Aria before they shred your mind and rend your flesh. The song's embrace will be harsh, but remember, every note you endure will lead to the Hive's undoing. Here, Guardian, I came to the moon with Eris and other lost warriors, not to end the nightmares, but to meet them, understand them. From that understanding, I expected to conquer their horrors and safeguard our past, present, and future. But the Hive are not simply waking terror. They are a dark mirror, a reflection of our fear to face in ourselves. Crota, Oryx, the Worm Gods, the Ascendant Plane, They are so much more than enemies of the unknowable. They are teachers. The fear they sow, a lesson. A path toward an evolution. We must tear every instrument of death they wield from their hearts, minds, and hands, and remake them to inflict our will. The will of the light. The will of life. Are your ears bleeding yet? The last skull we need is just ahead. The death song is yours to command. A new chorus to serenade your enemies with suffering. The final instrument is yours. Take the Death Singer's skull to Eris. Complete the weapon.
Toland now acts to us as guide in the matters of the Hive and the Darkness. When we met him in the Dreaming City, however, he joked about not wishing to be our Virgil. And yet later, as we prove ourselves, he calls us his Dante. His trenchant Dante, in fact. Trenchant being another word for sharp. This is kind of a call to the idea that he wishes to guide us towards a point through the certain hells that we endure. Where we can fight the darkness, and hopefully, with his guidance, do so more effectively. But we should really look into what he sees for our future trials, a future he predicts somewhat in the Bad Juju Lore tab, something that released back in the Season of Opulence, just before the darkness revealed itself. Listen to this. If you believe your weapon wants to end all existence, then so it will. Toland the Shattered. Hello again, my trenchant Dante. You have stepped in and out of sharp-edged worlds, hewn gods into blunt fractions, twinned yourself with powers whose names cannot even be held in the language of your little grey cells. You think yourself very high up on the pyramid of contumely. If you only knew how high that pyramid goes. Higher than I knew when my radiant killer unsung me from biological squalor, or when I witnessed a royal secret turn death into a chrysalis. Higher than I described in my journals, or told to our mutual three-eyed friend. Higher than even I, sailor upon the sea of screams that I am, can yet see. Perhaps I will tell you about them. You are right to ask why I would do so. Very good, dear Squanderer. Your intentions have grown sharp as thrall teeth. You see, they know what you are, what you were, what you will become. They know what lean tithes you are to them. Soft whetstones make for dull blades. This I define as the truth and tension of the rope. To bind, one must apply force at both ends. I think perhaps I will tell you after all. Toland may be guiding us towards the future, but it is a future that I think he believes will be bleak and full of darkness. And I think there is something more to be observed. Something that I will speak of later. Something that simply leads me to a conclusion. Even as we grow in power, we are eventually all lambs to be brought to the slaughter. But for now, I will leave you with this. Toland is a valuable resource. Use him as such. Remember that he has his own reasons for being, and remember that whilst we are his trenchant Dante, he is a somewhat unwilling Virgil. In the meantime, thank you so much for watching. If you enjoyed this video, go ahead and leave a like, and of course also leave your thoughts in the comments section down below. The next video on Toland will probably be something to do with his philosophy and his beliefs in the logic of the sword. And if you want to see that video, go ahead and hit subscribe and the bell next to subscribe to turn on those email notifications. But as always, know that your viewership is quite enough for me. And in the meantime, my name has been My Name is Bife. Purudasya Adastra. I'll see you, Starside.